Can you see the slides now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. I can see the slides, sir. Can you hear my voice, sir?
Yeah, it's audible.
Ilamaran voice kekuda?
Nalla nalla theriyudhu. Nalla kekudhu.
Nalla kekudhu.
Your video, I can just lower it. I mean, thala paadi thala dhaan theriyudhu.
So today I'll be talking about febrile seizures. So the most commonly faced questions. So is it a febrile seizure and what type of febrile seizures? How to manage the acute seizures? Because when it comes to emergencies, we start with management first and then we go ahead simultaneously with the evaluation and whether EEG and MRI is to be done. These are the commonly faced questions by the physician. Next one. And the other one is whether any prophylaxis should be given or not. If at all it is given, whether it is intermittent or continuous febrile seizure prophylaxis. So these are the commonly faced questions. Next slide. So the any child that comes with fever and seizures, is it febrile seizures? This is a common question. Or are we missing anything that is important? So what is febrile seizures? Any child in the age of around 6 months to 6 years of age having seizures in the presence of fever, that is 38 degrees Celsius and 100.4 degree Fahrenheit without any intracranial infection or neurological malformations. And the degree of fever matters, that is the height of fever matters, not the rate of rise in temperature. So this is a definition for febrile seizures. Seizures in the presence of fever with this particular age group, 6 months to 6 years of age. Next slide. Next slide.
I think there is some problem with Thirumurugan's connection. Thirumurugan, silent actor.
His image is stuck.
Probably disconnected to me.
You can continue to present.
Sorry, sir, I think I lost my signal. Sorry. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, I lost my internet connection. Sorry, please continue.
Can continue now.
Slides venu, sir.
Slide share aagalingala, sorry. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Then going to the basics, around 2 to 4% of children in less than 5 years are affected. Here also there are variations. There are differences in many regions of the continent. More of this, there is an island called Maritana Island, which is more affected. And other one country is Japan. In India, the range is around 5% maximum. And it is mainly age-dependent phenomenon with a strong genetic predisposition. Because most of the children have fever, but not all children have seizures. So it's mainly age-dependent phenomenon because of the immaturity of the nervous system and with the strong familial predisposition. Most of the time, if the siblings or the parents have seizures, these children are also more prone to seizures. And another one thing is around 30% of them have recurrences. The younger the age group, there are more chances of recurrence. Then coming to simple febrile seizures, as we all of us know, simple febrile seizures, it is a single episode. It is a GTCS lasting for less than 15 minutes. Mean duration is around 3 to 4 minutes. So this is about simple febrile seizures. Next slide, sir. So if it is prolonged, then this is complex febrile seizures. It is prolonged in nature, which lasts for more than 15 minutes. It is focal and multiple in nature. That is within 24 hours, there will be more than one episode of seizures. And complex febrile seizures, the importance of recognizing it is, there is higher incidence of recurrence as well as future afebrile seizures. This is the importance of recognizing complex febrile seizures. Next, coming to acute management of febrile seizures. So So first episode of febrile seizures, the most common thing that we have to rule out is acute intracranial infection. So these children who have acute intracranial infection usually present with high-grade fever, irritability, lethargy, bulging anterior fontanelle, and altered sensorium. And sometimes there can be non-epileptic events like shivering that can also come under differential diagnosis of febrile seizure. But the most important thing is we have to rule out So, an acute episode, the duration, if it lasts for more than 5 minutes, only then it needs to be treated. Suppose if someone is coming directly from home to hospital, then there is all probability that the seizure has lasted for more than 5 minutes, so better to treat. At home, the best possible medications will be intranasal midazolam or rectal diazepam. If there is any paramedics on the way to hospital in the ambulance, IM midazolam or IM lorazepam can be given. In the hospital, it is always better to give IV diazepam or IV lorazepam. The dose is 0.1 to 0.2 for diazepam, and lorazepam 0.05 to 0.1 mg per kg. A maximum of 3 doses can be given. Going to the next slide. At home, again, rectal diazepam gel can be given. The dose varies according to the age group. And intranasal midazolam also can be tried. All these are available in our country. Next slide, sir. Next one. Status epilepticus. This is another entity which has to be managed just like other status epilepticus. You have to load phenytoin after 3 doses of either midazolam, lorazepam, or diazepam. And you have to manage fever. This is quite common in children less than 2 years of age. Suppose if the child is less than 1 year, or even for children less than 18 months, better to do an LP and to rule out meningitis. So coming to the fever part. So for fever, we need to give paracetamol 15 mg per kg per dose every 6 hourly. So the one important thing about paracetamol is it has to be given in as oral route only, because rectal route absorption is not reliable. IV is not approved for fever and better not to use, and or better not to overtreat fever. And one more thing is this paracetamol or any NSAIDs for the matter, they reduce the discomfort associated with fever, but they do not prevent the recurrence. So, but parents are very worried about fever in a known case of febrile seizures. So their phobia has to be taken care of. And counseling is most important when it comes to febrile seizures. So the next question is when to admit and what type of febrile seizures have to be admitted. So simple febrile seizures. Simple febrile seizures do not require hospital admissions. We can monitor, but when the child becomes normal, we can discharge the child home. And then parents have to be educated about the risk of recurrence as well as the importance of intermittent febrile seizure prophylaxis if at all needed in a case of simple febrile seizures. Next slide, sir. Complex febrile seizures, better to admit the child for minimum 24 to 48 hours, particularly when the seizure is a prolonged type and focal in nature, because there is higher risk of having multiple seizures within the index illness, and recurrences is also very common compared to simple febrile seizures. Recurrences is around 90% within the first 24 hours. So it is always better to admit these children both for evaluation as well as for treating minimum for 24 to 48 hours. Next slide, sir. So investigations, what all tests to do? So the most important thing is to do a lumbar puncture to rule out CNS infections. So these are the criteria or clinical pointers towards CNS infection. Lethargy beyond the postictal state. So maximum postictal states last for around 30 minutes. So not more than that. Sometimes very rarely it goes for 1 hour. Unstable clinical status, petechiae, nuchal rigidity, irritability, and bulging fontanelle. These are the indicators for meningitis. And the other indicator for doing an LP is suspected antibiotic masking meningeal signs. Sometimes we can, previously someone else might have used antibiotics, which might mask these signs. Then one more indication is when the child is less than 18 months. They tell 1 year, but up to 18 months, we can go ahead with lumbar puncture. Suppose if there is strong clinical suspicion of meningitis. And less than 1 year, they are more prone for febrile status epilepticus. So better to rule out meningitis. Next, the role for EEG. Simple febrile seizures, there is no role for EEG. In complex febrile seizures, it is optional. Suppose more the number of complex features, better to go ahead with EEG, particularly if it is prolonged type or focal in nature with persisting focal neurological deficit with the Todd's palsy. Previous slide, sir. With the Todd's palsy, it is better to go ahead with the EEG. So EEG in case of febrile status epilepticus shows focal EEG slowing or attenuation, which is suggestive of hippocampal injury. And this EEG, you know, it is useful for predicting future risk of epilepsy, but this is not used for the basis of treatment decisions or for starting EEG. So it mainly recognizes epilepsy-related syndromes. So next, coming to neuroimaging. The most common neuroimaging that we do for febrile seizures is MRI. So the indications are febrile status epilepticus, so for which we can do without contrast. And suppose if we suspect any neurodevelopmental abnormality, particularly hippocampal maldevelopment or abnormality, then that will show T2 hyperintensities. And developmental abnormalities like inversion, volume loss, which is again non-specific. But these are the indications for neuroimaging, febrile status epilepticus and neurological maldevelopment. This hippocampal maldevelopment is particularly seen in mesangial temporal sclerosis and the febrile status epilepticus. Next comes the iron deficiency anemia. There are so many articles that say that iron deficiency anemia could be a possible association with febrile seizures. So better to screen all the children for iron deficiency. So this is according to Nelson standards, to do a hemogram with RBC indices, peripheral smear and ferritin. So iron deficiency role association is there, but causation is not there. So, but definitely there are other benefits when you treat it. And treating iron deficiencies, it is questionable whether it reduces the recurrences. Next slide, sir. So sending home and answering queries to the parents. So this is most important, parental counseling. So we have to counsel, next slide, sir. We have to counsel the parents regarding the fear. Fever phobia is very common and anxiety is very high because both fever and seizures are there. With only fever also, parents worry a lot. These children have both fever and seizures. So we have to tell them appropriately, particularly about recurrence and intermittent prophylaxis. And we have to explain the benign nature of simple febrile seizures. What to do and what not to do. That has to be given as a written documentation, which is better. Better than verbal alone. Next slide, sir. So specific information, what to tell. The most important thing is benign nature of simple febrile seizures. Like there is no sequelae in future and the risk of epilepsy is very minimal. For simple febrile seizure, the risk of epilepsy is only 1% more compared to the common population. And during seizure, what to do, what not to do, and use of midazolam nasal spray as well as rectal diazepam, and also to watch for afebrile episodes of seizures. So this will give a clue related to genetic syndromes. The next question is recurrence. This is a common thing that parents ask, whether the child will have recurrence of seizures. So the major factor that determines recurrence is age of the child. So younger the age, more the risk of recurrence. Particularly if the child is less than 1 year, there is 50 to 65% of chances and only 20% in older children. So younger the children, more the chances of febrile seizure recurrence. Next slide, sir. So the other factors which determines the recurrence. So age of onset less than 15 months, epilepsy in first degree relative, febrile seizures in first degree relative, brief latency between the onset of fever and seizures. Suppose the shorter the duration between the fever and seizures, then there is more chance for recurrence. And frequent fever episodes and attending daycare center. This daycare center is because from the other children, they can acquire viral infections. So that in turn can lead to seizures. And relatively low fever at the seizure onset. Suppose the seizure threshold is very less, that even at low grade of fever itself, if the child is having seizures, then there is more possibility of recurrence of febrile seizures. So these are the recurrence. More the number of risk factors, more the chances of recurrence. So if there are no risk factors, there is 10% chance of recurrence. 1 to 2 risk factors, there is 25 to 50% chance. 3 or more risk factors, there is 50 to 100% chance of recurrence. Fever phobia. So only when fever occurs, better to give paracetamol because there is no prophylactic role for any NSAID. And better to use antipyretics at the first sign of fever. This antipyretics, it only comforts the child and reduces the fever, but it does not prevent the recurrence of febrile seizures. So whether to give preventive therapy or not. So preventive use of anti-seizure drugs. So this anti-epileptic drugs, that is intermittent prophylaxis, it definitely decreases the risk of recurrent febrile seizures. But the problem is simple febrile seizure is of benign nature. So whether to really give intermittent prophylaxis is questionable. So these are the indications to give intermittent preventive therapy. So whether it is simple or complex febrile seizures, suppose the frequency is 3 or more in 6 months or 4 or more in 1 year or complex febrile seizures. Previous slide, sir. Complex febrile seizures, particularly if it is prolonged type and if there is associated focal neurological deficit after the episode and if the patient do not have access to medical care, that is they are residing in a remote place and too much of apprehension of the parents, or if the child is staying with the grandparents or during travel. These are the indications for intermittent febrile seizure prophylaxis. The drug used are diazepam and clobazam. The doses for diazepam 0.3 mg per kg per dose 8 hourly. And clobazam is maximum doses 0.75 mg per kg per day in 2 divided doses. A few more slides, sir. I'll finish fast.
I lost the...
So, next slide, sir. So, here the problem is we have to take into account the side effects as well as the benefits. So, this is the most common indications. Like I told you, complex febrile seizures, younger age of the child, it is definitely indicated because recurrence is anticipated as well as parental anxiety. Risk has to be weighed against the benefits. So how long to give? So around 50 to 75% of children within 1 year of the initial seizures, recurrences can happen and recurrences occurs within 2 years. So better to give intermittent prophylaxis till 2 years after the first episode. So it's given for 2 years. So about the child's future, this is another question. So we can always tell neurological deficits, intellectual impairment and behavioral disorders will not be there. Suppose if it is a febrile status epilepticus, then it can lead to rarely to sequelae. Particularly, there is a chance of epilepsy in around 5% of children. Next slide, sir. So epilepsy risk. What are the risk factors for epilepsy in children with febrile seizures? Suppose a child is presenting with seizures of focal nature, prolonged duration of seizures, and repeated episodes within 24 hours. And the other important risk factor is suppose if there is family history of epilepsy, that is also another important risk factor. So if there is no risk factor, the chance is 2.4%. If all three risk factors are there, the chances of epilepsy in future is around 49%. So regular AEDs, that is regular anticonvulsants, in febrile seizure, there is no role. It is used one and only if there is afebrile episodes. So in that case, we have to think of some of the syndromes that are associated with febrile seizures. EEG alone should not be used as a criteria for starting anticonvulsants. So recurrences, if they are too many, too frequent or prolonged or afebrile episodes, we have to think of febrile seizures associated with some genetic syndromes. We'll see some of the genetic syndromes in the next few slides. So this is genetic epilepsies associated with channelopathies. It can be either sodium, potassium or calcium channel mutation. The most common being sodium channel mutation. There are spectrum of disorders. So we need to suspect genetic epilepsy in a case of febrile seizure. Suppose if the child is younger age at onset with multiple recurrence, and if the febrile seizure continues beyond 6 years of age, if there is strong history of febrile seizures in the family or family history of epilepsy, and there is change in the type of seizures. Suppose there is sudden onset, untriggered absence seizures or myoclonic jerks. So these are the indications you have to think of associated genetic epilepsies with febrile seizures. So this is called as genetic epilepsy with febrile seizures plus. So unlike typical febrile seizures, here what happens is the seizures continues beyond 6 years of age. It will be both febrile as well as afebrile seizures, and it is associated with channel mutations, common as sodium channel mutations. In just genetic epilepsy with febrile seizures plus, it is sodium channel beta 1 subunit mutations, and they have both febrile and afebrile episodes, and these children have to be started with sodium valproate. They need long-term anti-epileptic drugs, and prognosis is generally good. There is spontaneous remission of seizures by the age of 11 years. So this is one important thing that you have to remember. The other one is Dravet syndrome. The onset is during the infancy period in a previously well child. So initially it starts as febrile seizure, but it progresses to recurrent afebrile febrile seizures, which is prolonged and focal. So it is only clinical diagnosis, and there is mutation in sodium channel alpha 1 subunit gene. So the treatment is valproate plus or minus clobazam. Then ketogenic diet helps in around 50% of patients. Stiripentol can be used, but the problem with the Dravet syndrome is the prognosis is not so good. There is developmental regression as well as there is risk of sudden death related to epilepsy. These are the problems with Dravet syndrome. And summing up the slides, acute episode. We have to clinically differentiate from CNS infections. Always do an LP if there is suspicion of meningitis. And LP is indicated in all the children less than 18 months of age. And in children with complex febrile seizure, particularly if it is prolonged and focal nature, and always do a CNS examination after the acute episode is over. If there is persisting focal neurological deficit, definitely admit the child and do a lumbar puncture, because there is high chance of recurrence as well as epilepsy risk. And this LP is commonly indicated apart from the previous indications. In febrile status epilepticus, it is definitely indicated. And to sum up, EEG, it is indicated in complex febrile seizure prolonged type, short palsy and focal neurological deficit, febrile status. MRI also is indicated in febrile status epilepticus. In this, MRI will show hippocampal swelling. And management and hope, this I already said in my previous slide. Any seizure episode lasting more than 5 minutes, better to give midazolam. So in Indian context, we can give diazepam, either rectal or oral. And children less than 1 year of age with complex febrile seizures, remote area, parental anxiety, and we always weigh the risk. And because anticonvulsants has its own side effects. And you have to educate the parents. Next slide, sir. You have to educate the parents regarding the benign nature, the recurrence risk, and how to use midazolam spray at home, and how to not to overtreat fever and allay the fever phobia. Next slide, sir. So finally, for simple febrile seizures, admission is not needed. Monitoring is more than enough. EEG, MRI, intermittent preventive prophylaxis is not needed unless the seizure is recurrent, that is more than 4 per year. In complex febrile seizure, you admit the child of minimum 24 to 48 hours. And EEG is done if complex febrile seizure is prolonged in nature and focal with Todd's palsy. MRI is not needed. Intermittent prophylaxis is better to give if the child is less than 1 year. and the other indications I have said already. For febrile status epilepticus, definitely admit the child. EEG and MRI always should be taken, and intermittent prophylaxis must be started. So to sum up, since the febrile seizures,